I want to share here is not just the things that I've said till now, but a whole lot of other issues of operationalizing the functioning of a hospital, of the much maligned mental hospital, according to the NABH standards, which actually have been framed mostly for medical settings. Fairly stringent standards for medical settings to be now applied to a psychiatric hospital, thank you, and to a mental hospital setting has been a very interesting, very educative process. We are still not entirely there. We have few months more of the final revisions for the accreditation process. Hopefully, in a few months, inshallah, we'll be NABH accredited, in which case, it will be the first psychiatric or the new psychiatric hospital in the country to be NABH accredited. But that apart, the outcome apart, the process I want to share here is very interesting in terms of that exercise of operationalizing things and making it user-friendly and accountable to the user's groups. And we started merely as an internal exercise. I mean, NABH was not even in existence then remotely. In 2001-2, we started the practice of putting down standard operating procedures for anything and everything that we were doing. And by now, for the mental health services, various aspects, we have about 23 SOPs already in place, some of which are listed here. And so that is what has helped us do some of the stuff that we do with NABH or the other such agencies, including NHRC. We really consider Board of Visitors as a very useful, not only just welcome, but a very useful provision. I know there is a lot of mental health institutions and mental hospitals who find Board of Visitors more of a pain than hell. We have really found Board of Visitors to be a very useful provision. That's a breakup of the admissions, that small number of admissions that we make. A large number of them being under Section 19. And so the pluses and minuses of Section 19 in Mental Health Act and what it does or what it doesn't do. Is a point that I don't want to raise just for discussion. Maybe I will save time on this, but there's a whole lot of active work that not only our doctors and psychiatric social work and social work colleagues do, but there's also a whole lot of active liaisoning with the police and the NGOs in Delhi and outside, including Panyam, that we get into for that effective discharge and rehabilitation rate. Data for the 3 years from 04 to 06 for that most difficult task that mental hospitals have. State psychiatric hospitals getting cases through the police and the magistracy mostly end up contributing to those long stay patients and the congestion there. And I think this is something that really, really needs to be understood and highlighted and if possible upscaled to all those 42 institutions that we still have. Merely as one of the major strategies for prevention of institutionalization. I was thinking this morning while taking a final look at this slide that it is unfortunately the indication of still the medical model and the thought that the hospital follows that we still call it load. We still look at it as load of services, which we ought not. But I must say I realized this morning that we still see it as a load of psychiatric services. But that gives you some idea of the hospital and the outreach services that the hospital and its teams handle. To come to the second part, in the year 2000, the Ministry of Health, Government of India, asked Vivas to start implementation of the DMHP, NMHP program in Delhi. With a fairly clear verbal talk and understanding, as well as I think on record understanding, that was the first DMHP program in an urban area. The Bellary model being implemented in a whole lot of rural areas in different states was fine. And I had been for some years before that, in the years at NIMHANS and later at All India Institute, been very aware of the potential success and a whole lot that Mohan Isaac has already said yesterday about DMHP, and rightly so. But the limitations that model would have or module would have in urban areas. For the homeless populations, for the urban poor, for a whole lot of other needs. And so we had on record made it very clear to the Ministry of Health Government of India that we are not going to follow the Bellary model in toto or pari passu. They were going to try and modify it to the urban mental health needs. And over the last 7 or 8 years, that implementation that has now gone from one district to 5 districts in Delhi out of 9, as well as a major ICMR multi-site research project, Delhi, Lucknow, Chennai, on urban mental health services in a research mode. These two together, the service delivery experience through the DMHP implementation in Delhi and the ICMR research project that we had, we were lucky to have Mona Hasek also on the advisory committee of, to guide us through this process of how do you adapt the Bellary module, the rural module to urban mental health needs, has now led us to formulation of an urban mental health module, call it a module, call it a program, call it a strategy, call it a variant of DMHP, honestly beyond settlement, like Shakespeare said. The name is not a crucial issue, but the recognition that one of the gaps, in addition to what Mona Hasek so eloquently said yesterday about few critical elements, I think one critical element that seems to be missed is that there needs to be a recognition that the urban mental health needs are different, the strategies that you require are different, the mechanisms that you require are different, and the partnerships that you'll have to link yourself with as a mental health agency for meeting the urban mental health needs are very different. And if in the course of the discussion in the day, if you get opportunity in time, I certainly would love to elaborate on that. That's the geographical map. For those of us who are not familiar, we are located in a northeast tip of the corner. Not very surprising because this is the old mental health hospital that was thrown to the back of beyonds. So we are nowhere near the swank central or south Delhi parts. Anyone of you coming to Delhi and spending months might not even think of Ivas or come to know of Ivas' existence because we are in that far-flung area. But the important point that I want to make is that the outreach services actually have been intentionally planned to reach the other corners where the urban poor cannot get public-funded mental health services. Nearly 5 districts, the 4 districts still closer to us. The ones here, the 4 districts closer to us here are still not being covered, but we do believe that that can take a bit of a backseat, or can we hope that Ivas, being where it is, does meet those needs, and certainly not the central and south, central and central district, because that's all the Lutens bungalow zone. The other thing that I want to highlight here is that we have been, and not terribly successfully till now, I must say, but we have been attempting, and sincerely so, to try and integrate the hospital and community-based services. In most places, except for looking at the data of heavy reduced the load on mental hospital, and stuff, there hasn't really been an effort at integrating the hospital-based and community-based services. And some of these things that I have said here, I'll not elaborate on that, but we really have. And a bilateral referral process. In almost all of medical practice, and including psychiatric practice, private sector or government for sure, there is very little thought, forget practice, of the back referral from tertiary care to the primary or secondary care. There is certainly the upward flow, formally or informally, from primary or secondary to tertiary care. But does the backflow occur from tertiary care to the primary or secondary care? Would a specialist or a specialty hospital be keen to send the person back to the PLC doctor who sent the patient to you, with a note and a collaboration assured? The other thing that we are getting interested in for last few years more is not merely mental health institutions or social welfare institutions which have large number of populations, but all residential care institutions in the country. And I have discovered a few years ago that 4% of the Indian population lives in institutions.
So this includes jails?
All. In the US, this figure is much larger. But 4%, I don't think, is a small proportion or a number. 4% of our citizenry lives in long-term, if not lifelong, residential care facilities across sectors. Please step out of health and mental health and social welfare. Census.
Is it faulty data, sir?
Sorry?
Is it faulty data? Because the new census has started.
Yeah, so till it gets completed, I'll have to keep quoting this.
Started, and they came to me. And last question I asked them, where can I put my disability in your list? This one, there is no place. There is no place for marking the disability of a person who is staying in the house. How will they know how many disabled persons are there in the institution?
Yeah, I'm not talking about disabled persons in institutions. I'm really talking about
mentally ill persons. I talk about.
Sure. Can I?